Arsene, that period of rivalry between the two clubs is one of the great periods in Premier League history. And at the heart of it was your relationship, your rivalry with Sir Alex Ferguson. And he sent a message this evening saying, "It's a great honour to be inducted into the Premier League Hall of Fame. And I would also like to pass on my congratulations to the former players who've also been inducted." To Arsene, like myself, you understand the unique pressures that come with managing an elite football club, a job you did with distinction for over 20 years. Congratulations to you, Petta, Rio and Tony. I hope you all have a great evening. Arsene, that rivalry, at the heart of it, we enjoyed it. We loved the passion. We loved the moments where it spilled over. At the heart of it for you, was there respect?
Yeah, of course. Respect came in late. It was close on the border sometimes of respect, but it came in later. But I came on the 1st of October 96, thanks to David Dean, who was crazy enough to bring me in here as completely unknown. And I would like tonight to thank as well Pat Rice, who was my legendary assistant, you know. And I would like as well to congratulate, of course, Sir Alex Ferguson, who is certainly the greatest manager of the Premier League. And the players, you know, Peter Cech, you have heard Rio Ferdinand and Peter Schmeichel. You had a good combination and example of what the top-level sportsman is, a combination of intelligence and absolute motivation. And the two together. One without the other never works. I had players who were very motivated but couldn't analyze well what's happening to them, and players who analyzed well but were not motivated enough to do it. And that never be happy. The constant question is at our level was, what is your next level in life? You know, and in sport, that makes the champions.
Are those same qualities, those of innate ability plus intuition and motivation, are they required to be a great manager as well?
All of them. All the top players can be top managers. But you have to sacrifice your life, you know, and accept that with nothing else in your life. I started to manage at the age of 32 in the top league in France, and I finished at 69, and that is 37 years complete dedication to what is the next game, how can I win the next game, and be completely destroyed after every defeat, and I had a few. And, of course, extremely happy only by the result of the last football game. That is what it is about. And today, when I'm out now for 4 years or 5 years, I realize that I was an animal, you know, only focused to what is my next drug, and sacrificed completely big aspects of my life, and I become a normal human being now.
But when you think back to those early moments, or that time when David Dean, when Arsenal approached you to come to manage them, what were your thoughts about what you could do with this football club?
Well, I had my beliefs, because when I came to England, it was I was 47 years old. I came from Japan. I had to adapt in Japan. I was manager of the year in Japan. So I had in France before, but I was unknown. Information didn't travel as quickly as it does today. And so we have seen Tony Adams there, you know, a lot of skepticism around me. And I thought, look, is as well a good opportunity to show that I have a level to guide them, and because at the end of the day, a coach is a guide. He tells to a group of people, look, I can help you to win, trust me. But you have to gain that trust. And the trust comes through reliability. That means you need a consistency in your behavior and in your beliefs. And it comes as well through the capacity of connecting individual people to create intimacy, that capacity to look in the eyes of a player and he trusts you, you know. And so you need the two. And so I just tried to create a trust base and to as well be faithful to my methods. When you go to foreign country, you have to go with your beliefs, but as well adapt to the local culture and share the local culture. Like Peter explained, that you have to speak the language. But it was interesting what Rio said about Carrick or Peter about the defenders. It's basically we fight against time as a player. And when we inform somebody in front of us, we give him time to respond. Because great players have a great capacity to take information before they get the ball. But sometimes on the cross, they have not time. So you have to tell them. Or sometimes he doesn't see what's going on in his back, so you have to tell them. But the capacity to take information before you get the ball is the most important quality at the top level.
You're talking about these qualities of players at sort of innate level. And yet you brought in all these innovations in the Premier League. You know, the mannequins were quite new at the time. GPS tracking analysts at the training ground. And you had to sell to the players that you were going to ban chocolate, which I can't imagine went down terribly well. But there was, I mean, attention to dentistry. There was no detail too small for you to
yes,
care
I
about.
I try to improve myself as well and to understand where can I improve and how can I help the players to improve. And I thought every single aspect of a top-level life is very important. And why should you practice the whole week and destroy yourself because you eat stupid things, you know, and have a bad game when it matters so much? So I try to get the players. In fact, you have to create an environment that helps the players to be as good as they could be. Performing a culture of performance, what Ferguson created at Manchester United is that he created a culture inside the club where performance was a necessity. I remember when we lost 99 in the semi-final at Villa Park against Man United, the year they made the treble, Dennis Bergkamp missed a penalty in added time. They never seen them so wild, so hungry for success. Was with all these young players who were very talented at Manchester United and had a huge hunger to destroy us. And it was quite scary how they were after the game when they beat us in the semi-final. I felt these guys will be difficult, you know, to deal with because they had such special hunger.
And when you talk about that special hunger. Obviously, there were players who were already there. You talked about Tony Adams, that famous Arsenal back four were already at the club. But you brought in Patrick Vieira, Thierry Henry, Dennis Bergkamp was at the club as well. How did you marry the traditions and the let's call them more old school players because Tony isn't here and the new breed that you brought into the club?
Yes, when I arrived, I think nine players were over 30 years old. So when you are a manager, you know this is a bomb because they will try to kill you because at some stage you have to tell them you're not good enough anymore. And before they go, they want to kill you. So I had to extend them as much as I could and slowly replace them. But as well at the start, I added the top players. You know, Thierry Henry, Dennis Bergkamp was already here. David Dean brought him in before, but Patrick Vieira, Emmanuel Petit were exceptional football players. So we had these guys were men. They learned football not in an academy. They learned football by battling in the lower leagues and in the street. And when they told you, don't worry, on Saturday we will do it, they will do it. You know, they're very reliable people. And at the top level, that is a very important quality, that you can rely on people. They do not, Rio spoke about that, I did 7 out of 10. They did every week. You know, the top players, they are consistent in their performance. And that's why data are important, because data shows that there's a consistency in the performance of the players, week in, week out. They play the same number of balls forward, the same number of balls sideways. And that's why you can rely on data.
Talking of reliable, and more. 2003-2004, Premier League champions, 26 wins, 12 draws, zero defeats. That invincible season, at which point did you think this could happen?
Well, I was like the players. I thought we won the championship in 2002. And I thought, what can I do better? Maybe somebody else could have won the championship as well. We made the double. What can I do more? And I thought, maybe, I said in a press conference, maybe we could win the championship without losing a game. In 2003, we lost the championship to Man United. And in pre-season, we went away in the training camp, and I said to the players, why did we not win the championship? They said to me, because of you. And I said, okay, but why? They said, because you put too much pressure on us. But in fact, we were unbeaten away from home, and we lost at home, and we lost the championship. So that's where the crucial moment of a manager is. Or you say, okay, sorry, I was wrong. Or you say, but I'm sure you can do it if you really want it. So I went that way, you know. And it shows that sometimes you have not to be scared, because in England that is the case, you know. If you're too ambitious, he's a cocky, arrogant. And if you're not, don't do it, of course, you're humiliated. So sometimes don't be scared to be ambitious. And secondly as well, what is a very important lesson for me is that you have to put the seeds in the brain and be patient. It takes sometimes time to get in the brain and come out, and on that front. But on top of that all, I discovered what it is to be a manager without any fear. I just traveled to the games, no fear at all to lose, you know, because you lose the memory of losing games. And we were joking before the game, we were completely relaxed because fear doesn't exist anymore. And fear is a big, big important factor in our job. We don't talk about it, but everybody has fear. And when this fear disappears, and the other important interesting factor was that people could raise above their ego. They just wanted to become better as a unit. Because ego looks always for confidence and compares itself to others. What has he more than I have? In the dressing room, that's constant, you know. And so during that period, the players could raise above their ego.
Could it happen again, do you think?
It can. It can. I think you had, after that, you had teams who were as good as we were. Man United, Chelsea had top teams who could have done it as well. But you need a bit of luck as well, and maybe you need really to do it, because sometimes when you win the championship, the concentration goes a little bit. But I thought it's good, because it is really to do the job as well as you can do it. And that is basically what it is about.
Your influence at the club goes so deep that it was only a few weeks ago, a couple of months ago, that Arsenal played a team that had no player in the starting 11 that hadn't played under you. That's how long your legacy has lasted at this club. There is still that Arsene Wenger influence in the Arsenal side, who are now going for the title under Mikel Arteta. How do you feel when you watch them this season?
I'm very happy, because I believe they played with Man City. They are the two best teams who played the most attractive football. And They play, they're light, mobile, light on their feet. They make intelligent decisions in the final third. They have a desire to play together in the final third, what is very interesting to see. And you feel a huge potential there. I feel that Arsenal at the moment, they have in every position a good enough player to win the Premiership. They face, of course, a tough opponent with Man City, and maybe we'll be lucky a bit tonight, you never know. But the potential is there. But you have to grab your chance when you can, because never know, next year Liverpool or Chelsea, I don't know, the big teams can come up and fight again for the championship.
And Arsene, just a question on the players in the Premier League at the moment. There will be some of them who will eventually be Premier League Hall of Famers, but of this current crop of players, which are the ones, or who's the one that you think would be the player who would fit in an Arsene Wenger Premier League title?
I would say many Arsenal players certainly will come in here, but the one who's ready maybe to move in this Hall of Fame, who has been consistent over the last 7-8 years, is maybe De Bruyne, who has been exceptional in efficiency and quality and decisiveness in the big game.
Yeah, he potentially is a Hall of Famer, if not already staked his claim for a place in the future, but he has to have retired in able to do that. Arsenal, it's been an... That's the trick, isn't it? Always when we say Arsene, we think Arsenal. And that, I think, is the legacy that you leave at the football club and in the Premier League. Ladies and gentlemen, Arsene Wenger.
Thank you.